Your Holiness, Bhakti Bhagwat Kamrupa Hari Maharaj, please accept my most humble prostrated obeisances into the dust of the lotus feet. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Your Holiness. Maharaj, this is your humble servant, Abhay Charan Das, from ISKCON Uttar Royalty Department. I have been serving here for last about 7 years under the shelter and divine guidance of His Holiness, Bhakti Swami Maharaj. Maharaj, here in this video, I wish to show you about how we prepare the wood that we use for making the altars. So, we buy the wood from the auction directly from the forest. The way it is done in India is all the wood which is grown in the forest is under the control of the government, and the government sells it. So that is the first source. People buy from the government and then they sell to other people. So what we do, we directly buy from the government so that we can get the best prices. Now the altar actually is made of many small pieces of wood which are designed, carved, and then they are glued together to make a big piece. This is how it gives it structural strength also, because like arch is there, so if you make it in one piece it will be weak, because all the sections of the arch will be in one grain pattern only, then it will be weak, and even while carving it can break. So the process itself necessitates that we have to use small pieces of it. But what we do is we buy bigger pieces of logs. Like here what you are seeing is after the logs are bought, we saw them, like this is the upper part of the log, then these are middle parts, like that. Different parts of the logs are there. The logs are sawn and they are kept for drying. So suppose we have to start making an altar now, then we don't use the wood that was bought last month. We use the wood that was bought 1 year back, and we keep on rotating our stock of wood in this way. So once the logs are there, then we keep them for natural seasoning. They just keep on drying like that, and when the wood is wet, we use moisture meter. So teak wood generally doesn't have so much moisture as other varieties of wood have, like neem, babool, other local Indian varieties of wood. They have very high moisture content, about 50% when we go to the deep inside part of the wood. But in case of teak wood, generally the maximum moisture content in the inside part is about 30 to 35%. But when we want to use a piece of wood for our final work, which is like after storing it in the form of logs, then after again cutting them into small pieces and then getting it into this form, so this kind of a piece has a moisture content of, let's say, 10-11%. So anything which is below 12% is acceptable for our work, and naturally we can feel that it becomes quite light. Any other piece which is looking heavy, then its moisture content is high. So in this way we can understand which piece of wood is suitable to be used for making the altar. Carpenters and there are carvers. Then there is a similarly big workshop only for polishing, like that. Then separate section for gold dipping and separate section for packing, display and all those things. So this is carpentry and carving. So here after the different pieces of wood, which are checked for their moisture content below 12% or so, they are prepared by carpenters, either by turning or by cutting, like I was mentioning about arch. All these different parts are made. The carpenters assemble them, then they are given to the carvers who carve them. Then this beautiful grape design is done in the pillar. So the most significant or one of the most important parts or thing in our wood is the deep natural grain pattern. There, teak wood is just a name, just like mango is a name. But within that name mango, there is very high quality Alfonso mango available in India, and there are very inferior qualities of mango is also available. Similarly, Keepwood is just a name, but in order to judge the quality of Keepwood, one of the parameters is the kind of oil content it has got, the kind of natural grain pattern it has got, the kind of strength it has got, resistance to termites, ease of carving. All these parameters are very important. And the wood that we are buying ranks practically the best in all these parameters. And especially it is very unique for deep natural grain pattern. Now we are seeing it in this form, after getting polished, the natural grain pattern will come in a very, very pronounced way. Suppliers who give altars like this, but we can judge whether they are using cheap price imported teak wood, because that wood is commercially grown and does not have this kind of natural grain pattern. While this wood is grown naturally, when the trees become mature after a minimum of 30 years or more, then they develop this kind of deep natural grain pattern. This kind of high oil content comes. But other commercially grown teakwood, which is generally imported from Central America or Western Africa, it is grown within 10 years and a tree grows into a very big tree. But the grain pattern is not there, so that is how we can check whether the supplier is giving a low quality imported cheaply bought teakwood, or he is giving a high quality properly grown. The tree that has properly grown, the wood that is coming from a properly mature tree. So that we can judge by looking at this wood. After the carpentry work is done, there are the carvers. They are very fast and expert. Very detailed in their work. They hand carve the wood. The process of hand carving is very, very interesting and very, very diligent also. What they do is, first they use the wood and then they draw the pattern on the wood. That pattern is drawn on the wood. After that they mark with their tool, and after marking with the tool, then they will take off the wood. Like, it involves a lot of steps. And finally, this kind of a thing, like this is just a, this will be an elephant eventually. There will be ears attached to it from sides. Otherwise, if we make them in the same body, then they will be weak. So we have to put them as joints. Actually, generally, joining or putting joints is not considered a good thing. But in wood carving, in order to give strength, giving joints becomes a necessity. Because suppose if some part is there, the natural grain is like this, and if I don't give a joint here, then the natural grain will naturally break. Because for one piece, for some particular areas, the grain orientation may be favorable. But for some other area, the grain orientation may not be favorable. So in order to ensure that for all the parts of a particular big piece of art, the grain orientation is favorable to the strength of the piece, we have to put the joints. And made into a perfect shape by the devotees who do sending. So here we are seeing how sending is happening. He is very meticulously going at each and every nook and corner and trying to make sure that everything is perfectly smooth. And we do this kind of sending 3 times. There is sending, then there is one coat of spray, then there is again sending, then another coat of spray, then again sending, then another coat of spray. So when 3 times this process is repeated, then the whole work becomes very, very smooth and shiny.